So you have your Eventbrite account. Congratulations. Now it's time to actually start using it. Go figure, right? Stay tuned. We're going to watch this video and you're going to be interacting with me right here on your screen. And we're going to walk you through exactly how to set up an event on Eventbrite. I love using Eventbrite, not only to fill events, but to just bring people together for gatherings. And if you've ever used Eventbrite, you'll see that everyone's using it for everything from social gatherings to announcements. It's just top to bottom, a great platform to use. And here we're gonna walk through creating an actual event. So what I'm gonna invite you to do is go ahead and pull up another screen right next to this video. Just open up another browser screen and you know, just set it right next to me so we can walk through this together, because you're going to be watching my screen and doing it at the same time. So if any point during this video you feel like you want to pause, you need to grab a graphic or grab a picture or anything off the file, do it, pause it. I'll be right here when you get back. So let's do this side by side. We're going to walk you through A to Z on how to do this, okay? Okay, so you've got your site up. You're going to www.eventbrite.com. Make sure it's spelled correctly. Eventbrite's funny about that. It's B-R-I-T-E, not B-R-I-G-H-T, okay? So you can see, you know, it even shows you where we're at right now. Check it out. We're in Lehi, Utah. And Eventbrite is so awesome because they're going to promote your event for you based on the analytics of the customers that are already there. I've put on events where people came to it and found it organically, not because I promoted it or put an ad on Facebook. They just found me organically because I put my event out there. That's one reason that you love Eventbrite. Okay, so let's just walk through this real quick. And if your event's awesome enough, they'll even, you know, show it right here on this little preview space here. Okay, so let's go. The magic button's top right over here. Click Create Event. That's your happy place, okay? It's always a good idea before you get started to have your graphics, if you're using any art or any logos or anything, you have those just ready to go on your hard drive. So for this event, let's create a very short, succinct title. So let's say a six-figure mastermind. Oh, let's make sure that six is a six, not a carrot. Double check. Six-figure mastermind money making workshop. Now keep in mind, when you're creating a title for your event, who's gonna see it? Now this six-figure mastermind money making workshop, it's a little bit descriptive. You know, you feel like if you were to see this without knowing what six-figure mastermind was, or without knowing who I am, you can get a pretty good idea of what this event's gonna be all about just by the title. However, if I were blasting this to the general public, I would be more descriptive in my title. I would say something like, how to make money to build your business to six figures. Okay, that's obviously for entrepreneurs because it's about business building, right? So keep in mind who your audience is. If this is going to just your list, you can use a title like this that's very clear and descriptive, but it's also keeping in mind that they already know who you are. If it's intended for the general public, be more specific, because you're going to want to talk to your target audience, right? So you have your target audience, you know what their likes are, you know what their dislikes are, you know what their needs are. Most importantly, you know what problem you're solving. Include that in your title, but make it short and succinct, all right? You can do a location on here. If you have yet to do a location, you can do TBA, you know, apparently that's a real location in Salt Lake. Okay, so you can do TBA, or you can put your home, or let's say that you're hosting an event at the library. You can actually put in, if you spell it correctly, you can do the Salt Lake City Library. Boom, and it actually has the address auto-filled right there. Powered by Google, thank you very much. And it'll put a map in there for you. Bonus, right? So it's got the map, it's got the address, everything's all filled out. You don't have to go looking it up. If it's a public venue, it'll have all that information filled in for you. If it's a non-public venue, like let's say you're doing an event at your home, you can simply put in your address in there and it will remember it for next time. All right, you've got your location. Now let's do your start and end time. Now, this is cool. Eventbrite's been really working hard on the back end about making it easier for people to put scheduled event times in. So let's say you're doing this event, you know it's going to be once a month. You can actually schedule multiple events using a single event series, meaning you only have to do this once and you just click all the dates on the calendar that you want to use. That's super handy if you're doing repetitive events. For example, I know that there's a concealed carry permit class that happens frequently here in the Utah Valley, but it does happen at different venues and locations. They can use this to schedule those multiple events. I know it's $40 every time I go. I know that if it was my event, I know the venue and location and time for each one of those different events, and I can do it all right here. If it's an international event or a nationwide event, you can do the time zone, date and settings, just ensure that you're in the proper time zone for everyone's looking for your event. Especially if it's, you know, like a webinar or something that's digital, you can definitely include that in your venue here. So if it's a digital event, you'll be able to have your HTML put in so they can just click and get a reminder. So that's what makes Eventbrite so great, is you can use it for in-person events or you can use it for digital events like webinars or screencasts or whatever you happen to be doing, a teleseminar or whatever it is. Eventbrite's great for that. Okay, one thing Eventbrite gets a little specific on is your event image. Now, Eventbrite does this because their platform is pretty much universal for all of their events. Let me share with you just an example here really quick. Let's go to eventbrite.com and let's just click on an event that is already happening in this area, okay? Let's say employer breakfast and seminar. Okay, I'm just gonna click on this event. It's gonna open up for me and, the event's ended. So let's click on an event that actually hasn't happened yet. Utah Alliance 2018 Spring Meeting. When your event is done and posted, it will look very much like this. It will have the same layout, same formatting. And one thing that I love that Eventbrite does is they'll take your image and put it right here, but then it will take a very blurry version of your image. It'll blow it up and make it actually the background of your image, which, you know, it does a couple things. It creates a nice cohesive background, but it also makes sure that your colors match, which, you know, you don't need to think about, but it makes it very appealing for the people looking at your webpage. All right. So this one, if you just take it as an example, the tickets have a ticket range. You can go for free or you can go for $75. It's got your date and time here that will automatically add to their calendars if they want to do that. It's got the location. It's got the refund policy. Description is beautiful. They've got nice bullet points. They've got a registration and a bit.ly shortened link there and different tags. So again, this is a good thing to do. If you've never used Eventbrite before and you want to plan an event, open up an existing event that's similar to yours and just, you know, copy and paste things that are working. Obviously, you're going to change the information, you know, to match the specifics of your event, right? But you can take these great ideas, like if, for example, if you wanted to use these bullet points and they were relevant to your event, you can just totally R&D, right? Rip off and duplicate. Just, you know, make sure they're relevant to your event. Okay, so let's go back over to our event right over here. And you're going to add an event image. Now, I don't have an image for this event right now because this isn't going to be a real event. And again, I just left the start time and end time as it was auto-filled. But throw an event image in there and remember to check right below the event image. This will give you your pixel specifications. And you can usually use any photo editor to crop your image or whatever you need to do to make sure it matches these specifications. But this is, I can't even overstress how important this is to have your pixels right in line. Now, if your image is bigger than these ratios, it will auto crop it for you and you can determine where that crop is going to happen and how it's going to look when you're done. But if it's pre-cropped and ready to go, go ahead and just put it in there. You can also use Google to, you know, if your event is generic enough, and let's say it's a teaching event, you can go to Google and find a picture of kids raising their hands or a teacher in a classroom. You can just find a free stock footage and throw it in there as long as it matches that ratio and will fit within that window. And that's super easy to do. Okay. Again, no larger than 10 megabytes. It's, you know, not, don't want to overkill, right? Okay. Event description. use some compelling text to share what your event is about. People want it short, they want it sweet, and they want it to the point. That's why I love this bullet point idea. One thing to do is ask questions in your event description. So, have you ever wanted to grow your business to six figures? Okay, there's one question. Then I would ask another question. Maybe one that, you know, it's going to have to be relevant to your content. Are you an entrepreneur? That's a fun one to spell. Okay, another question could be, are you looking to network with other professionals in your business? Okay, I love to start out with these three questions because I'm addressing specifically the problem that needs to be solved. So I'll ask those three questions, then I'll tell about the event. I'll say, come check out our event. We're going to meet in this venue with these many people, and here's the three things that are going to be taught. Obviously, those three things are going to answer these three questions, right? And then you're going to give a bullet point list of benefits, just like you saw in this event right over here. This is a great example. You know, topics for discussion, you can do that, or benefits of the event, or what you'll learn at the event. Just create some kind of a bullet point that's going to share the features of your event. Okay, then throw in your organizer name. One thing I love about Eventbrite accounts is that you can run multiple events with different organizer names. So I'll have one account for multiple aspects of my business. So let's say that I have a joint venture partner that's running an event with me. I can put their organizer name in this space if it's relevant. Or I can have an employee put their organizer name in this event space. So let's say I have a business with multiple aspects. I've got a marketing division, I can put their name in there. I've got a customer service division, I can put their name in there, and I don't have to get brand new accounts. Very, very simple. Organizer description just follows right with your organizer name, and you can also put your links to Facebook and Twitter in there. Now, this is probably the most important part of opening up any Eventbrite event is your ticketing, all right? Now, we can do reserve seating, yeah, maybe, but most of the times we won't have to worry about that. My favorite thing to do is just pick your ticket here. You can do a free ticket, name your ticket, so you can say early bird or just RSVP, whatever you wanna do. Your quantity of tickets, okay? You can make sure that you're not overselling your event, unless that's your model, which I can't imagine why that would be. Okay, and that's pretty much it, okay? You can upgrade your Eventbrite. So this event, for example, they have 0 to 75, and if I click on tickets, it's gonna outline all of those options to buy. So a non-member is 75, a member is 40, and then I see these silver, gold, and platinum memberships. They're the free versions, okay? And they've got a tracking system so they can get all of that figured out, I'm sure, at least I hope, right? And that's because they have an upgraded Eventbrite membership. Now, you don't need to upgrade if you're not worried about having multiple different ticket levels at your event. If that is something that you need to do, just go ahead and upgrade your Eventbrite account. But on the free version, you can stick with just one version for your event. So if it's a free ticket, do that. If it's not a free ticket, or if you accidentally clicked free ticket, just click the trash can, delete the ticket type, and it will show you this bar again, okay? If I need to do a paid ticket to an event, just keep in mind that Eventbrite is going to charge you some fees, but that cost per ticket, you're just gonna have to roll that in and use that as an expense in your business. It'll keep track of it for you. Eventbrite will send you an invoice. You can pay it and write it off as a business expense. Just be aware that you will not only have an Eventbrite fee, but you'll also have a PayPal processing fee. And that's gonna be outlined in your PayPal account. Again, name your ticket here, name your quantity available, and name your price. So let's do an example. You've got 100 of them, and it's $29.99. All right, so the buyer total will show $32.22 because it's that fee on there. So the buyer is going to be paying part of that fee as it's set up right now. So, you know, be aware of that, all right? If you want to have the buyer total be less, you can do a couple of things. you can pass the fees on to your buyer and just change your price. So their price out the door, if you really are, you know, if it's really important to you that their price out the door is $29.99 or less, I would do a price of $27.99, for example, and just, you know, modify the price until it's that $29.99 out the door price. And you can just, you know, it's $29.63. I'd be happy with that. It's close enough. If you're okay with passing on the fees, you can change your price to, another way to eliminate those fees for your customers, if you want to keep that $29.99, is to go ahead and absorb the fees. If you go down here to fees and you click absorb fees, then you're going to be paying the fee and your buyers will still pay $29.99. So there's a couple options. You can change your price, you can absorb the fees, or you can just pass the fees on and let them pay $32.22. Okay, you know, either way works. It just depends on what you want the customer experience to be. You can set these ticket sales to start at a certain date and time. You can set them to end at a certain date and time, and then you can allow a certain number of tickets per order. All of these settings, most of them you don't have to worry about, but double check all of them as you're on your way through to make sure that it's what you want your customer to see. Again, option to upgrade if you want different ticket types in the same event. Set your refund policy. You want to set your additional settings, make it a public page or a private page depending on who this event is for. And then it's time to click the magic button. Make your event live. And if you're not ready, just click save. You can go visit it later. But if you're ready, click the magic button. Okay? And then this session has expired, and that's totally fine. But that when you click that magic button, your event's gonna go live, and that's what it's gonna look like. It's got your banner photo, it's got the beautiful pixelated blurry matching colors in the background. It's got your tickets right over here. It's got the name. It's the who the event's being put on by. Everything is listed right in here. Always double check, and you know, putting tags in. If your event is a public event, always put tags in there, because people are gonna say, let's check this out. And if, let's say if they find another event that has the same tag as yours and they click on the tag, it'll show them your event. Tags are super helpful. It's kind of like hashtags on Instagram for that way. So this is what your event is going to look like when it's done. Again, Eventbrite is very, very easy to use. Their interface is very user-friendly. Make sure you've got good graphics on there and that you have all your information on your event before you click live, so that by the time your customer sees it, you're ready to go. Okay, so you got your first event up and running. Be sure to check out our other videos on how to link your PayPal to your event so that you can make sure you get paid on your events that you're running. Hit the subscribe button and I'll see you tomorrow.